people forget to have fun. You know, they keep putting it off for another day until they have reached a certain number or they have got some targets to achieve, and you know, that day never comes because the targets keep changing.
Hello and welcome everyone. I am Vishal Khandelwal and this is the 1% Show. This show is an open-ended exploration into the minds of the wisest people around to help us learn to think, invest, and live each day a little, even as little as 1% better. You can learn more at vishalkhandelwal.com. My guest today is Professor Sanjay Bakshi, Managing Partner at ValueQuest Capital. He is one of India's best recognized finance professors who taught security analysis, behavioral finance, and business valuation at MDI Gurgaon for 20 years. And currently, he is distinguished adjunct professor at finance at Flame University, Pune. Professor Bakshi received his MSc in economics from London School of Economics and Political Science and BCom honors from the University of Delhi. He is also a fellow member of the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. The American historian Henry Adams said, and I quote, "A teacher affects eternity. He can never tell where his influence stops." Professor Bakshi has been that teacher to thousands of his students over the past two decades. I have also been a fortunate, even if an indirect beneficiary of his teachings. And so asking questions to him today makes me the most nervous I have been on this show so far. But with this and no further delay, Professor Bakshi, welcome to the 1% Show. I am so glad to get to talk to you today, and thank you so much for agreeing to do this in the first place.
Thanks, Vishal. Great to meet you again and keep meeting you often. And, you know, I've done a lot of stuff with you in the past. And as I read my old interviews with you and I see that, you know, I've changed quite a bit. I guess this happens to everybody.
That's right.
Our own relationship has actually changed quite a bit. If you, you know, think about it, we started out as, you know, friends, and then you became a student at one of my courses at Flame, and then you have been a teacher yourself, and now, as I learned recently, we are going to be colleagues. So I'm so glad that you are going to be teaching at Flame and I'm going to be teaching at Flame, so we are now colleagues. So thank you.
But the student teacher relationship remains paramount for me, so I thank you so much for thank being you. That for me so much.
Thank you for having me in your show.
So let me start this conversation with three simple questions in continuation of the one that Ian Castle asked you in his interview 6 years back. He asked what you enjoy doing outside teaching and investing, and you replied, "I read, and I also love to play pranks on my kids, wife, friends, and their kids. One should never grow up. It's a trap." So here are my three simple questions to begin this session. One, tell us about the best book you have read recently. Two, what is the latest prank you played on someone? And three, what is the biggest trap that you have found about growing up?
Wow, so the question number one itself is three-part question and very different, you know, subjects in each part. Books, I'm a firm believer in what is called as the Lindy effect. And we know about that, and, you know, I think you've written about it also. Basically, old ideas tend to stay around for long. And I don't believe in the idea of reading new books just for the sake of it. So the book that I've read recently, actually reread, is a book on the Mandukya Upanishad by Swami Chinmayananda. It's a very old book. If anybody wants to read this book, I would recommend that before reading this book, they should watch two videos by Swami Sarvapriyananda on this Upanishad, the Mandukya Upanishad. It's called Who Am I? And they were delivered many, many years ago at IIM Kanpur by Swami Sarvapriyananda. So watch those videos, then read the book. It'll change you completely. And it has changed me completely. So, you know, it's a book I keep going back to, apart from many other books, which you call as super texts. So you ask, by the way, there's another Twitter handle that I follow, which I think is the best, my most loved Twitter handle. It's called The Ancient Sage. not very many people know about it, but it's something that I would recommend all your listeners to follow, The Ancient Sage, and go through his or her Twitter profile and the tweets that he or she has published over the years, and they are absolutely amazing. Pranks. Everybody who knows me personally thinks that I'm basically a prankster who never grew up. You know, all my school friends, my college friends, my family, my kids' friends, my neighbors, they all think of me as a guy who never grew up. And I really like that because, you know, it's a trap. You're right. I mean, when I told Ian that growing up is a trap, I genuinely believe in that, you know. Anyway, so you asked me about pranks. You know, I play one every other day. So the latest one, or the one which was most admired by the people who fell prey to it, was by this five-year-old kid who is a friend. He lives like two houses away. He's like 50 years younger to me. He's a friend of mine, and we chat together. We meet often. So he came over, and you know, we all have Alexas these days in our devices, on phones and on the Alexa devices. So I told him to ask Alexa to tell him some fart sounds and jokes. And he did that. And of course, if you do that, and I don't want to do it on this show, but you can do it on your own. And he was in fits. And then he went and played that prank on his grandparents in a get together. And, you know, it was quite hilarious. So it's a lot of fun that you can do. Pranks and technology actually go quite well. So I love combining technology with pranking friends.
Alexa helps a lot over there, I'm sure.
Absolutely. You asked about, you know, what is the biggest trap that you have found about growing up? There are many of them. I mean, one biggest trap that I see as an educator when I see grown-up people is that they sort of lose their curiosity. And, you know, when you interact with kids, you find that one thing they have all in common is they're extremely curious. They're always asking why this, why that, why not this, why not that. And it's very irritating for parents to have children who are extremely curious, but that is the key, I think, because, you know, as you grow old, you lose all that. You sort of start accepting the world the way it is, and you don't question anything. And it's basically, we stop asking why, we just accept. And we also end up collecting a lot of baggage, right, over the years. You know, we call it experience. But experience is sort of a double-edged sword. A child has no experience. He or she would have a blank slate. He or she would ask innocent questions that you have lost the ability to ask because you have this baggage. So, you know, when you talk about experience, I genuinely feel that experience itself is a sort of a double-edged sword out there. There's another big trap that I want to talk about, and that's to do with you know, being serious. You know, as we grow older, we stop having fun. You know, we take everything very seriously. And of course, there is ambition and there are life goals and there are responsibilities and all that. But, you know, when you are involved in taking care of all these things, you stop having fun. And I don't like that at all. You know, one of the things that I see happen around me, around the world, is the idea of chasing money. And of course, it's a good thing to do up to a point, but, you know, beyond that, it becomes a means to itself, right? So, you know, you don't have fun anymore. People forget to have fun. You know, they keep putting it off for another day until they have reached a certain number or they have got some targets to achieve, and, you know, that day never comes because the targets keep changing. And I remember Seneca wrote this wonderful essay called On the Shortness of Life, and he basically tells you about the opportunity cost of everything. So everything that you do has an opportunity cost. So every action that you take, every thing that you decide to do has a cost. And he talks about that in this essay. And I love that essay. I recommend it to all of your listeners. And I require my students to read it, because I think it's the best way to understand the importance of opportunity cost. As you grow older, you realize these things, and you don't realize them when you're young. So one of the things that I've sort of realized over the years as I've become older is that there is an opportunity cost to everything. And, you know, you can't keep chasing things just for the sake of that. And there are things that are important to you, and you should focus on those things. And time is not going to come back. You know, Seneca gives a wonderful example. He says, if you lend money to somebody and he doesn't pay you, you can always make back that money. But if you lend your time to somebody and you wasted that time is never going to come back. So it's a very important distinction that he makes in that essay. A lot of people spend a lot of time doing things that they will regret having spent time on when they approach their deathbeds. And this is another aspect of philosophy. You know, Seneca and other Stoic philosophers, they ask you to contemplate on your death, that you're about to die. And how are you going to think back on your life as to what you did in that life? And a lot of people, I think, would say that, well, I forgot to have all the fun. I kept doing this and that and these goals and those things and these objectives, but I didn't have the fun because I kept putting it off for another day. And today, it's just too late.
That's right. I think your insights on this not having fun as we grow up reminds me of that Australian nurse who wrote a book about the top five regrets of the dying. And that the first biggest regret was that I wish I could have lived the life in my own way rather than what the society or other people outside me actually wanted to. And I should have had fun, right? So that's the biggest regret of dying. And I also remember one quote where someone said that we all almost die at 25, but we are only buried at 75, right? So
the thing is, we think we're immortals, you know. We know at the back of the mind that, you know, we are not immortals. Everybody's going to die, but we don't think about that too often. It's considered to be sort of, you know, not good to think about dying. But it's a reality, right? So it's going to happen to everybody. And if you think about your own death, your own mortality, the impermanence of everything, including you, then maybe you would think that time is running out and you would spend time differently. I think that's one way to think about this.
That's right. You talked about spirituality, right? And you also recommended a book around that, the Upanishad. I have talked to Manish Chokhani earlier in the show, Vinod Sethi in the show, right? There is something about being an investor for a few decades and following that spiritual path, whether you're making a decision or whether you're just living a life, right? I'm not talking about praying and religion, all those kind of stuff. I'm talking about spirituality as a mindset, right? So has investing or being an investor, looking at businesses, looking at evolution of businesses using those mental models as Charlie Munger talked about, right? Has that played a role in the spirituality that you talk about, that you the sense that you've developed over years, right? There's something that connects investing to spirituality. So what's your take on that?
Yeah, I know. Well, this is a very fascinating topic, and absolutely, I think the example of the Lindy effect comes again. You know, all wisdom is ancient, and a lot of it is spiritual. There are so many old ideas that I find as an educator when I read spiritual texts from different cultures, that they have been repackaged and been converted into modern ideas. And some people have even got big awards for publishing those ideas, including in the world of finance. So absolutely, I think there are a lot of old ideas that have been around for a long time, which have a great, and they're all spiritual ideas, and they have great relevance for modern thinkers, for investors, for everybody. I mean, I can give you some examples if you want. If you recall that, you know, we have this idea called loss aversion, and Danny Kahneman and his partner got Nobel Prize for the prospect theory. And basically they said that people overreact to losses. And Charlie Munger once beautifully put it that the quantity of a displeasure from a $100 loss is much more than the quantity of a pleasure from a $100 gain. And this is something that is observable, and we can check this from so many experiments, that people treat losses far more disproportionately as compared to gains. And this is a known phenomenon. And there is the spiritual idea of equanimity, that if you should treat losses and gains as if they were the same. you should practice equanimity. And it's an old idea. It was first mentioned in Dhammapada, which is a Buddhist text. And it's about balance, right? And this is an old idea. Again, I'm just mentioning it here because it's not an idea that we're not familiar with. Anybody who has got even a little bit of spiritual knowledge would know that equanimity is one of the most important ideas in spiritual thought. But we call it today loss aversion, and you know, and it's sort of been repackaged as loss aversion. And similarly, if you think about detachment, you know, so many cultures they talk about detachment. We repackage it as a commitment bias right now. You know, to be detached from outcomes. I mean, Krishna tells that to Arjuna, right? In the Mahabharata, right? We all know that. To be detached from your own conclusions, to focus on the task at hand and not to think about the outcomes. And we now call it the process versus outcome matrix. So I keep seeing these modern ideas, but you know, if you think about them, a lot of them are based on or actually are exactly replicas of very old spiritual ideas. The power of silence is also appreciated in so many cultures, you know, being quiet and being more contemplative. Meditation, for example, is a key practice followed in so many cultures. We talk now in the context of signal and noise. You know, there is so much noise out there. How do you, you know, eliminate the noise? How do you become more reflective? How do you become more contemplative? How do you use system two thinking instead of system one thinking? Now we have converted them into system one and system two. We have old spiritual ideas about avoiding temptations. There will be all sorts of temptations. And in the world of business, in the world of investing, we know what happens to business people who give in to temptations to do things that they will regret later on. And we see the same thing in the world of investing. These are very old ideas, you know. We call them now the marshmallow experiment or the idea of, you know, delayed gratification. We give new labels and they make subjects for wonderful books, and people who explain these things are not doing anything wrong. But the point I'm making here is very simple, that these are not new ideas. This is like a old wine in a new bottle. There is this old Advaitic philosophy of, you know, what is real and what is unreal. And Buffett has called it the inner scorecard and the outer scorecard. So I can go on and on. So it's a very fascinating subject here. I don't want to take too much of your time on this, just this one question. But I do think that there is a lot of wisdom out there, one, which is ancient. A lot of it is in the spiritual texts. And number three, it has a lot of bearing on our day-to-day work, including, you know, how we run our professions. And of course, modern management textbooks and other authors have taken those ideas. They may not even be actually aware of the existence of those ideas going back thousands of years. And we accept them as modern concepts, but they're not modern. They're actually quite ancient.
Mm-hmm. That's fascinating. Do you have a morning routine, right? Some people like to read, some write, some meditate, or some exercise, right? What do you do?
So one thing which I learned a few, and this is to a great deal of irritation to my family, is the importance of sleep. You know, I read this book on sleep. I read up a lot of books on the importance of sleep and how important it is to sleep well, and not just the quantity of sleep, but the quality of sleep, which include the consistency of sleep, the ratio of REM to non-REM sleep. I mean, all sorts of parameters are there. I then started a routine over the last 2 or 3 years of, you know, sleeping early and getting up at 5:30 a.m. So I get up at 5:30 a.m. every day. There are some days in which I'm not able to get up because I did party and I was not able to get up. That there are always exceptions, but by and large I get up at 5:30 every day. Morning routine is always being with oneself, and one of the most important things is not to check the email, not to read the email or the news or any of don't do that because it sort of unsettles your mind. You're starting early, you want to be more reflective. So I have a ritual. I go and make my own coffee, and I take time making my own coffee. I'll have my coffee and I'll just be with myself. Maybe I will read some messages on some WhatsApp groups of some friends, never work-related WhatsApp groups. I mean, just to open the day I'll make a list of things that I want to accomplish during the day, and it'll be a short list. It can't be a long list. So I'm not a great believer of long to-do lists. I can't parallel process. So I will make a list of two or three things that I want to do today. And oftentimes I can't get to number three. I can only do one and two. So that's what I think about basically. My morning routine is get up early, be with myself, don't read the papers or anything that can unsettle your mind until the day has begun, much later, a few hours later. And make a list of things that you want to do today.
Going back to your life story, I think, which you shared a long time back to your next student who asked a question about, right? Your life story suggests that you have lived through multiple periods of extreme uncertainty, and mostly those periods were created out of your own choices, right? What gave you the courage to first create such uncertainties in your life and then deal well with them, right? So that's a question. And do they have some roots in your early childhood, that is, in the period much before you took your first big decision that changed your life?
Well, I was 11 years old and I ran away from school and I ran away from home. I basically disappeared. And I'm not going to go into the reason as to why that happened. Obviously, I must have been involved in some shit in life, right? At age 11, I disappeared and I had no idea where I'm going to be. I was not going back home and I was not returning to school. And this has been a very common factor for me, at least, and maybe millions of other people, that they do face uncertainties in life and they sort of don't mind it so much. And for me, always, you made a reference to something I wrote back in 2004, and since then many years have gone by. But I wrote about some big decisions that I had taken until then, and I've discovered that almost all of them involved burning bridges, so there is no turning back. You make a decision one fine day and you burn the bridge that you just crossed. So you can't go back to it, which sort of conflicts with the other philosophy of preserving optionality and keeping your options open and delaying your decision until the very last moment. And there are times when you should preserve optionality and there are times you should burn the bridges. Big decisions for me, at least, have almost always involved burning bridges. And this is true, as I think, even beyond the essay that the email that you're referring to that I wrote to an ex-student in 2004. So I'm actually not at all uncomfortable dealing with uncertainty or creating uncertainty, because sometimes life gives you choices and you have to sometimes make decisions which involve blowing up or rather burning the bridges that you just crossed. So that's the way it has been with me, and I'm not saying that's the way it should be for everybody, but I'm just telling you how it's played out for me.
Sure. A quick question on that subject of running away from home, if you want to answer that. Where did you go and when did you come back, if you actually went back home?
I actually ended up in Chanakyapuri, and I was in the middle of night. I was walking down the streets with no money in my pocket. This is March, a cold, wintry night in March, in school uniform, which was shorts, and a blazer which had very little wool in it. So I was like shivering, and I was sleeping on the bus stop, and I had no idea where I'm going to go. And this security guard of the U.S. embassy saw me, and he took me to his house, and then he brought me home after a while. So yeah, I spent only one night, but that one night was quite uncertain. I had no idea where I'm going to be.
Sure, that's true. Before we get into investing, right? So I want to seek your insights on I think something which is much more closer to your heart, which is teaching, right? You taught at MDI for 20 years and have now joined Flame University to continue your passion for teaching. So what, in your experience of these last two decades, is the most fascinating aspect of being a teacher, right? And what motivates you to be a teacher, like to your students day after day?
Well, I think you'll share this feeling with me. You're a teacher yourself, sort of elevates you completely, right? So teaching is a form of giving, but it's also a form of receiving, because you get better at whatever you're practicing just by teaching. And it's a known secret for all teachers that they become better at that subject simply because they're teaching it, right? So so that's one part of it. I teach to learn. I mean, the ideas that I've taught over the years, many of them get dropped out because they were not powerful enough. And there is this survivorship bias out there, you know, rather I should say the reinforcement effect of teaching and reteaching ideas that have real power and real strength and real quality, that sort of get reinforced in your own thinking because you're repeating the same things that have really, really worked for you and for others that you've observed and brought into your classroom. So that's one part of it. I teach to learn and I enjoy that. But there's a second part, which is the upliftment that I get, or rather the respect that I received and the love and affection that I have received over the years. You know, I wear two hats. I wear the hat of a money manager and I wear the hat of a teacher. The love and affection, or rather the payback that I get from teaching, no amount of money can match that. I feel, and I genuinely mean this, I've been to all sorts of places around the world, and suddenly a student would come up to me out of nowhere and touch my feet in places that I've been to where there's hardly anybody there. And the point I'm making is that teachers, as they become older, they would have taught thousands and thousands of students, and their love for you remains unchanged. Whereas if you are a client, service provider relationship, that relationship is very different. And of course, you need both. You know, your teaching doesn't pay very well, so you need a different profession. But I do feel that teaching is has been very, very helpful to me, and I really, really enjoyed it. I'm never going to give that up.
Completely agree with you on this, right? So I think a lot of people get a dopamine effect from earning a lot of money, right? Being a teacher, I think there's nothing, in my experience, right? Nothing gives you that kind of a kick, if I were to use that word, that like being a teacher has been, or someone, like you said, someone recognizing you in a place where you don't expect to be recognized, right? So I remember in my family, I visited the US like a couple of years back with my family. Was standing on a bus stop waiting for a bus in Los Angeles to take us somewhere. And there were two young guys, right, who got down from a cab and they recognized me, right? So on a barren street in a far off land, right? So that's the best memory that I have of that 1 month in US 2 years back. So completely with you on this, right? So,
the flip side, you know, we all wear hats, right? So I was at a get together with college friends doing my totally different, wearing the mask of college a student, or just partying with my friends, and I was doing things that I wouldn't be doing if I were the teacher, and some of the students are watching me. So it was fun later on to discover that the student discovered that there's the other side of our professor, who is basically a clown. So, you know, the thing about being a teacher and having taught so many students who have gone all over the world is that you will sometimes be found in little awkward situations, because then you're not wearing the teacher's hat, you're wearing somebody else's hat and behaving, playing that part.
That's right, that's right. We last talked in detail in March 2014, which is just about 7 years ago, right? But seems a different time period altogether. So just to give the listeners some perspective, India had not reached Mars by then. Alexa and Apple Watch did not exist. Uber and Airbnb were still small startups. Warren Buffett's Berkshire had not yet bought Apple. Narendra Modi was not the Prime Minister of India, and Volkswagen was a clean company. And the COVID virus was still confined to the research labs. I'm sure, like you have constantly done over the years, you must have been a different kind of investor in 2014 than now. So my question is, how has your evolution been over these years, and what have you picked up in this journey of the last 7-8 years, and what have you given up?
So great question. Actually, I started investing in 1994. So 20 years had already gone by. By then I had transitioned from being a bargain hunter, Ben Graham kind of investor into more of a investing in better quality businesses. But since 2014 till date, I have become, I think, even more appreciative of structural qualities or defects in business models. So I've started really appreciating looking at business models from the point of view of an architect. That is this a strong business model or a weak business model? And you can go as deep as you want. You know, there is a lot of wisdom in this space, I feel. And you can look at it from the point of view of a spectrum. You know, you may have a business that is robust, or you may have a business that is basically fragile, or you may have a business that is anti-fragile. And I find that very, very interesting, you know, viewing business models from a structural point of view. And by the way, this applies not just to analysis of different industries, but even companies within a given industry. I mean, take, for example, businesses involved in lending money. So there are all sorts of businesses that lend money. And of course, it's a business that is perceived as a risky business. So there's a spectrum. On one end, you have businesses that are extremely risky because the people who run those businesses, they take unacceptable credit risks. They may lend money to people who will not pay you back, so NPA issue, or they may have risk concentration. They may have asset liability mismatch. I mean, these are like accidents waiting to happen. So on one end, you have lending businesses that are extremely risky. Then there are some which are less risky. They are run by prudent bankers or prudent lenders, and they know the meaning of risk. They know downside risk. They know how to mitigate that. They know about how to, you know, limit exposure to a given variable, and they are always looking for ways of finding correlations between different kinds of things that can blow up the balance sheet. So they're very good at risk management. So there is this kind of business which is sort of less risky. Some are very safe. So there are some forms of lending that I regard as extremely safe because they're collateralized, and the collateral has a few conditions that are met. I mean, the collateral is in your possession and you can sell it whenever you want. It's very liquid it has a value which is independent of the circumstances of the borrower, which is not the case in normal corporate lending businesses. And then you have another part of the spectrum, the extreme right part, which is, I think, is extraordinarily safe, which is like bulletproof, where you can't have NPAs. I mean, you're designed. I mean, by the way, all of these are listed businesses, and I don't want to take names here, but within the space of lending businesses also, there are businesses. So people who are, you know, looking at lending businesses, they think, oh, there is leverage, and if I don't want to look at it. But if you go deeper, you will find some structurally beautiful business model within the lending space. And then you will find some structurally very weak business models, which may be thriving right now, but they're like accidents waiting to happen because they're taking risks that are paying off. But if you keep playing the same game over and over again, eventually you will blow. And that's law of probability. We are familiar with that. So the point I'm making is that I've become much more interested in these looking at a business from a distance, from a structural point of view, keeping in mind that the inherent strengths of businesses will also change over time. So it's not like it's dynamic, right? Because businesses, when they start up, they are fragile. They have one customer. They are very small. They are dependent on outside capital. But as they become bigger and better over time, they may develop a competitive advantage. They may have many more customers. They may reduce vendor concentration risk. They may become self-sustaining in terms of generating cash, and their dependence on outside capital markets goes away, and so on and so forth. I mean, there are so many ways of thinking about it. The point I'm making is that you can even look at it from the point of view of a journey as to where is this business headed. Is it going to move on the spectrum from fragile to robust to perhaps anti-fragile? Is it moving towards becoming an extremely strong business, or is it moving away from being a strong business because the management has changed, or they become complacent into a weak business? So it's very interesting to me as an academic or even as a business analyst to observe businesses and to see how their journey has been and to contemplate over where they're headed on this dimension. So that's one thing that has happened. The other thing that has happened in 2014, around that time, even before that, I did many lectures. Some of them are published on my blog about case studies that I used to do, and I used to think in terms of expected returns going forward, making careful projections about business volumes and prices and costs, and thinking about a reasonable multiple that you would apply to forward earnings, and then coming up with some potential future value, and then bringing that and comparing it with the current value, and to figure out what the expected return is going to be. And I've sort of moved away from that kind of thinking, because I've learned from experience that a big part of the return is based on multiple changes, and that's not in your control. So if you're building a model, and if you have, basically there are only three pieces, right? You have dividend, you have earnings growth, and you have multiple changes. It could be multiple re-ratings, or it could be de-rating. Two of these are in your control, and one of them is not in your control, because the third one, the multiple changes, is totally dependent on the behavior of other people, and you can't control the behavior of other people, right? And therefore, if you value a business at 25 times earnings 10 years out, and right now it is selling at, let's say, 15 times earnings 10 years out, then if you amortize that change in multiple over 10 years, you will get a different expected return than if you were to amortize that change in just three years. So you want to hope that it will happen in 3 years, but it may not happen in 3 years, and it may never happen actually. It's something that you hope should happen, and probably should happen, because there are inherent qualities of the business. It's growing and it is selling at an undervalued valuation, but who knows when that undervaluation will go away? That's not in your control, right? So the moment you remove the role of multiple changes in the model, the numbers change. So basically you're playing around with numbers. So I sort of realized that. That's the other big thing that has happened since, that I don't think about those things anymore. Of course, I do want to be in businesses where I think there's a probability of a multiple going up, but I want to make money regardless of that. I want to make money from the dividend and earnings by itself. The growth of those things should be sufficient for me to own the business, and if there is a multiple re-rating that's going to happen, that will be like an icing on the cake, and that could turn out to be a big icing on the cake. So there is a part of the return which I now distinguish from that part of the return that I can predict, and the part of the return that I can't predict. I'm not saying that both won't work, they should both be there. The possibility of the second one being there is important, but you can't predict the timing of that happening. It could take 3 years, it could take 5 years, it could take 10 years. The other thing that I become much more aware of is the importance of slowing down and becoming far less active as compared to what I was even in 2014. So my typical ownership periods have gone up. And I think that's again a reflection of trying to become better at investing in high quality businesses, because these businesses don't change their quality very often. And therefore, it's important to slow down. And it's difficult to replace something that you let go of with something else, because they are, by definition, scarce, right? That was the other thing that has happened. So these are basically three or four things, and it's an evolution. Again, it's a journey. Again, I don't know if 5 years from now, if you call me again in your 1% show, I will probably give you more reasons to believe that I've changed again. And this is the way it is for everybody, right? We all change over time. And famous quote, no man steps in the same river twice, because it's not the same man and it's not the same river.
Sure. I think that ability to change your mind when I think, as Lord Keane said, when the facts change, right? I think one of the most difficult skill to master after sitting and not doing anything as far as investing is concerned, changing your mind, right? So I'm sure we'll see even a further evolved Professor Bakshi once we talk 5 years later. That'll be wonderful. Yeah, that's right. You talked about anti-fragility, and I just want to talk to you about that idea a bit, especially because we are going through an event, right? A crisis that really brings that idea to light, much, much light, right? Let me get you to this COVID crisis that had hit us last year and doesn't seem to live, right? In terms of your thought process as an investor and decision maker, how do you deal with such an event or situation where there is no precedence, where there's no playbook, and where there may be a lot of second and third order effects, right? And also, has there been any change in your thoughts on the risks and uncertainties after COVID? So see, that's the first part, yeah.
See, history doesn't exactly repeat itself, but it rhymes, right? So there are, when you say there is no precedent, no exact precedent, there will never be an exact precedent, you know, but there will be precedents. So you have to generalize, you have to go back in history and see, well, how many times in the world has seen crisis which has brought down market values of stocks? Crisis which appeared at that time to be monumental. And the people came to the conclusion that the world is basically going to come to an end. And the stock prices were down 50, 60, 70% for some of the best companies out there. And it has happened enough number of times. And if you go back and check what was the right thing to do at that time, you would always come to the conclusion that it was time to buy. The market is actually overreacting. It is not going to be the end of the world. So that's the baseline statistics. You already know that there are a number of occasions in the past where, speaking generally, when the world out there starts thinking that the world is going to come to an end and accordingly behaves in bringing down the valuations of businesses across the world, then they're wrong. So that's one thing we know from history. The second thing that I learned after this COVID thing was I knew, of course, we all know about the concept of anti-fragility. Taleb wrote about it so many years ago. But to appreciate it at a deeper level became much more obvious to me post-COVID, because I saw with my own eyes businesses that started thriving in this atmosphere. You know, for example, e-commerce or, you know, Zoom and so on. And there are many businesses that actually have done extremely well because they happened to be in the right place at the right time, and this COVID came and it lifted them to a different trajectory altogether. And that was a very interesting observation. So anti-fragility is almost, you know, synonymous to, you know, it's thinking about what happens when there's a big natural disaster. If there is a big tsunami or there's a big earthquake or there's a big geological event that wipes out a species, and what happens to other species that could not thrive because there was this dominant species that was ruling the planet, so to speak, and they all, you know, like dinosaurs, you know, they went away, right, suddenly. There are many theories as to why they went away, but we know that they went away in a very short period of time, and as a consequence, the mammals became the dominant species and humans amongst them. So the point here is a simple one, that these things happen, and it's important to take a detached view of what is really happening and to take the standpoint of Shakespeare. And he said that there is nothing good or bad, but only thinking makes it so, that there will be these situations that will come. When they come, there will be some businesses that will die, and it's sad to see them die. I'm not going to take away the emotions involved in seeing a business die. It's terrible for the employees and for the founders and for the shareholders and for the lenders. I understand that. But it's going to happen. It is what it is, that some things will die because they are weak or they are unlucky or both. And that's the way it works, plays in nature. Nature is very brutal, right? So the same thing applies in the world of business and in the world of investing. Some things are structurally weak because they have either too much leverage, or they have small size, or they have customer concentration risk, or they have vendor concentration risk, or they don't have pricing power. I mean, you can go on and on. There are all sorts of causes of mortality that exist. And then this thing happens, and then they suddenly die. So that happens. So that's the nature of the situation, that you will have these outcomes. And it's better to accept that in advance, that, you know, either you prepare yourself that I don't want to have these outcomes, and therefore you protect yourself, and in return for that you're sacrificing near-term returns because you are going out of protection. The other thing that I learned post-COVID was that so there's this one source of anti-fragility that comes by because you happen to be in the right place and you had a business model that boomed because of this event that has taken place. But I found that there is a far more common source of anti-fragility, which is just by being the strongest player in the industry and seeing the other weak players die right in front of you or become so weak that they're not able to compete with you effectively gives you value, gives you power, because the competitive intensity in the industry will go down. And that has happened in so many industries. So the second order effect is that just by not doing dumb things or just by doing smart things earlier and not participating in the folly of other people who are going on indiscriminate expansion during good times, not realizing that they are creating the source of their own demise if some economic collapse was to happen, is enough for you to thrive. So, you know, the thing about investing is the same that you see in the world of nature, that there are these species that would, or members of a species that would thrive because the other members of the same species were behaving in a very aggressive manner. So I found that, I started appreciating that a lot over the last few quarters and years, especially after COVID. So that's been the other thing that has happened.
Keeping aside the hat of investing in business, right, and looking beyond this pandemic, so how does one practice this idea of anti-fragility in a world that is changing rapidly and is full of uncertainty? So I'm talking about from a personal life, from an advice or something that you've done yourself to become more anti-fragile as an individual, right? So what are your suggestions that how can someone personally become more anti-fragile in a world which is changing rapidly and is full of uncertainties?
How to become anti-fragile? So that's a interesting question. I mean, the same logic applies here, right? What applies to businesses applies to individuals. So how does, let me give you an example. Let's say you are in the business of lending money in an industry, which is the lending industry. Now, how do you become anti-fragile? By not doing dumb things which other guys are doing. I mean, look at how many banks have blown up in the last few years, including, I'm not even talking about public sector banks, I'm talking about private sector banks, blown up. Basically, what I mean is that stockholders have lost more than 95% of their money from peak valuation. And there are other bankers in the same industry who did not die, who actually thrived. So what are the qualities that those bankers exhibited, which we gave them the quality of anti-fragility? Basically, independent mind, the ability to understand risk aggregation, the ability to not give in to temptation to see easy money in the near term, because it comes with certain risks that are regarded as unacceptable, and the willingness to step back and watch from a distance the blowing up of your peers because they're doing something extraordinarily dumb, which will make you look foolish in the short term. Basically, it boils down to being willing to look foolish without acting in a foolish manner. And that's not easy. That is very, very hard to do, because the world out there is measuring your performance on a very short-term basis. Outcomes matter. So if you're doing very well, you're considered to be very smart. Nobody thinks about how much risk you're taking to get the returns that you're delivering, whether it is in the lending business, whether it is in the investing business, it doesn't matter. So if you are doing something risky, like, you know, pulling a trigger on a gun which has a million bullets in it, million chambers in it, but only one bullet in it, well, the probability that you will not die is extraordinarily high, right? So you look like a hero for a long, long time until you die, and you'll die very quickly. When you pull the trigger, when the bullet is in the chamber, the instant death. So the point, and it's very important to recognize that the world is a lot like this, you know, gun bullet example that Buffett has talked about so often, which we use in our classrooms, right, all the time. But think about the guy who is not pulling the, who doesn't want to play the game. He says, I don't want to play this game at all. Now, what's going to happen to his performance, or what is going to happen to his outcomes, and what is going to happen to his fundamental performance? He's not going to look, his market shares will go down. He will be ceding market share. His growth rates would go down. His total aggregate profits in the industry will go down. Profit pool, you know, share will shrink. But the fact is, it doesn't matter. He doesn't care about that. He cares about survival. He cares about longevity. And he is operating in a world when he's competing with people who are not so worried about survival, but about profitability. So this whole trade-off between near-term profitability and long-term survival is so powerful that if it applies to the world of business and the world of investing, why should it not apply to the world of individuals? So how do individuals become anti-fragile? Well, how do you, on a personal level, it would be don't have any debt on your balance sheet. Have liquid assets on your balance sheet. Have the ability to deploy those, convert those liquid assets into long-term assets, which will create value over the long term, exactly when other guys are selling out because they have to, or because they're too scared about the world around you right now. So you develop anti-fragility by being a contrarian, but being right. It's, I think, wrong to being a contrarian just for the sake of being a contrarian. Sometimes the markets are right. Sometimes the world is right. You're not right just because you disagree with the world out there. So you have to be right on your data and your reasoning and all that. But you also have to have the conviction and the capability of acting on that conviction when the opportunity arises. And it will arise, and it will happen once or twice every decade or so. The whole thing is to recognize the opportunity and to seize it when it comes. And that's not common. A lot of people are able to recognize opportunities, but they don't have the money anymore at that time because they had not prepared for it. They didn't have a liquid balance sheet, or they had commitments to make, and they were overstretched in some way where they could not take advantage of the opportunity the world is throwing at them right now. So you become anti-fragile by being prepared, by waiting, by being patient, and by having an independent mindset.
And also a mindset of being being a survivor, so like survival mindset that you talked about, right?
Absolutely.
First thing to do is to survive. Yeah, applies to investing and life as well. So, right. Continuing with investing, right? We talk about the idea of developing an exponential growth mindset, but this pandemic once again proved the widespread inability of even the best decision makers, including policy makers at the highest level, to grasp this basic idea of exponential growth, right? Nobody expected, despite knowing that how viruses can grow exponentially, nobody expected them to behave that way. As a student of human behavior, does that surprise you? And as a teacher of human behavior, how does one go about developing such a mindset that is so important while investing and also while just living in a world that seems to be changing exponentially? So we all talk about compounding, right? We all understand the formula where it comes to compounding, whether it's money, habits, relationships, everything, right? But how do you actually go about developing such a mindset in a world which is changing exponentially?
But before I get into that, I want to say the exponential, if you're talking from the point of view of an investor, well, if you're wearing a hat of an investor and thinking about exponential growth, you don't need it to do well. I know that a lot of people are only interested in business opportunities or investment opportunities that offer them exponential growth, because obviously the math is very compelling. If it plays out, you're going to become rich quickly. Yes, if it plays out, right? But that's not the only way. It is a good way. No doubt about it. If you do it well, of course, you're going to make a lot of money in a very short period of time. But it's not the only way. So before I get into the importance of exponential growth and understanding it and how to develop a mindset for it, I want to just caution the listeners that it's not the only way. Value investing has got many dimensions to it, and there are many dimensions which don't require. In fact, you could be investing in businesses that are shrinking. You could be investing in businesses that are actually going to be disrupted. But because the market is overplaying the disruption risk and the degrowth risk, it might value it at a fraction of what those assets are worth today. Those risks are real. They will pan out. But the market is chasing exponential growth and not chasing degrowth leads to opportunities for investors, for many value investors. If you are investing in bankruptcies, for example, you're investing in a situation when there is an opportunity in bankruptcies. Graham taught that, right, in his classroom. That doesn't require an exponential mindset. you only requiring a mindset, will this company survive? And if it survives under normal operating conditions, what could it be worth and what is the value of the securities right now? And is there an arbitrage opportunity here between buying them now and seeing the reorganization take place? And whether, you know, I should buy the equity or the preferred stock or the convertible debt or the bonds or what have you. So all of that doesn't require exponential mindset. So there are all sorts of investing philosophies, even within the world of value investing, which does not require exponential mindset. Now, even within value investing, which includes growth investing, in my view, there are businesses that are not going to grow exponentially. They will grow at 12, 13, 14% per annum for a long, long time, and that's good enough. That's good enough to create value for you, provided you're not, you know, you paid a decently low price to own them. And yes, there are exponential growth opportunities, which are, you know, the businesses which have no earnings right now, but could be making tons and tons of money because they are growing exponentially. And at some point of time, they will start throwing off a lot of money. And everybody thinks of the next Amazon, but they don't think about the hundreds of other companies which are growing exponentially, which also blew up. So there is a lot of risk in investing in exponential growth. Now, let's talk about how do you develop the mindset. So obviously, you've already given the answer, which is to appreciate the power of compound interest. The power of compound interest is well known by people who think about compound interest formula outside the firm. So they know that, you know, if you're investing in fixed deposits, you will get 4-5% today. If you're investing in the Nifty, then you might earn 12-13% or something like that. Or if you compound money at 12% per annum versus 15% per annum, then the terminal values will be very different 30 years from now. People understand that. What they don't appreciate, I feel, is the compound interest inside a business, which is basically return on invested capital, which is also a compound interest, right? How much capital does the business have? How much it is earning on that? And that's the return on capital ratio, which is also a compound interest formula, provided you can continue to do that over a long period of time. So if you have a sufficiently large return on invested capital to begin with, then if you combine that with the ability to continue to earn a sufficiently large return on incremental capital, which will come from retention of earnings because you're not paying out all the earnings as dividends, then the math is very clear, right? It's a matter of time when the earnings and book values of the business will compound and become much, much larger than what they are right now. So it becomes very easy, and I've done talks on the mathematics of quality investing, but the math is actually very simple. So to be able to see why businesses have become so valuable over time, all you have to do is to go back and see what has happened to return on invested capital one. What was it to begin with? What it is right now? What has been in the intervening period, and what were the reinvestment opportunities? And if you plug it all back in the math, it fits very well to explain as to why this compound interest thing, this exponential growth thing, really, really works. So the only way I can teach it is to show examples of massive value creation that has happened in a growing country, especially like India, where there are these opportunities and people have become fabulously rich by owning some good quality businesses that became better over time and grew and grew and grew and have, you know, they just ignored everything. In fact, remind me of your recent charts, which was that shut up and wait. And wait.
And wait.
That's what they did. They just didn't look at anything else. They just bought good things and they saw them grow and grow, and they had the inherent or implicit faith in the power of compound interest, and it just plays out in the long run, right? The market cannot fail to recognize the appreciation in the business fundamentals over a long period of time, and that plays out. I don't know of any better way of teaching it, do you? You can always read books on exponential growth, and there are wonderful books out there to appreciate what is happening. But what better way to teach them, to show them that how much money people have made over the last 20 years by investing in good quality businesses, which have genuinely compounded their capital at a rapid pace, and look at how much money they have made.
That's true. I think that's definitely a difficult thing to teach, even when, so in my experience, even when you give examples, right, after examples of how people have used compound interest, not to grow their wealth like 20-25% per year, but even at like 14-15% or 12% per year for 20-30 years, they have done so well for themselves. But again, I think like I was talking to Morgan Housel in the last episode, and we brought up this case of Daniel Kahneman, who says that it's very difficult for us humans to actually perceive ourselves 20-30 years down the line. So even if someone asks you how, where would you be 20-30 years down the line, you actually don't see a person that you actually would be, right? It's very difficult for us to put ourselves 20-30 years down the line. And that's the reason we don't really, even after learning and seeing examples of others building wealth or developing their habits over 20-30 years, right? We fail to do that because we are not able to perceive. The mind does not allow us to perceive that. And that I think is the difficult part. So that has been my experience. So, but I think the idea is to persist, keep sharing more examples, keep teaching by sharing more examples. I think
but also to demonstrate. You see, as teachers, it's our duty to even show to students that how exponential growth can also result in blow ups. People don't see that. You see, look at what has happened to some of these retail companies, which sort of blew up. Because they were growing so rapidly. Because if you do the math again, if you have a low margin, if you don't have the working capital cycle right, then if you grow, the more you grow, the quicker you are moving towards bankruptcy. It can be shown. And you know, so growth is not always good. In fact, in lending businesses, very rapid growth is almost always a sign of, it's a sort of a red flag, for me at least, and I've seen that. The most rapidly growing lending businesses have a propensity to blow up. There are exceptions, no doubt about it. It's not a law, it's a tendency. So it's for me a sort of a red flag. So I'm always attracted to slow growing or less growing or moderately growing businesses, especially when you're dealing with leverage.
On to behavioral finance. So how can you, as a teacher of behavioral finance, try to start to chip away at the biggest problem in investing, which is the problem of how people behave, right? So I would love to hear tangible examples of things that you have done or the systems that you have set up for yourself to stop making all those same stupid common mistakes. And I'm sure it's very difficult to eliminate them completely, despite being a teacher or a practitioner for 20-30 years. But how have you done, or what have you done to minimize those mistakes in your own investing journey or as a decision maker?
So again, see, the easy part is recognizing. And there's a cottage industry for all these biases, which tell you how do you recognize that you have this bias or that bias and whatnot. The curing of that bias is the hardest part. By the way, I don't want to claim that I've been cured. I'm not. You know, I keep making mistakes. Every year there are a few, which I write down in my diary and try to learn from them and hopefully not repeat the same kind of mistakes. But then, you know, knowing what we are, we'll invent new ways of making new mistakes going forward. And also, it's not supposed to be easy. It will be hard. And there are reasons why it is hard. And this is something which a lot of people already know. I mean, because, you see, we are really fighting evolution. We are fighting billions of years of evolution. Because what we call today as a bias or a tendency to go wrong is something that gave us an improved probability of survival and having children in a different context, you know, a few million years ago, for example. So I'm very interested in this particular aspect, and I talk about this in the classroom a lot as to why, when you look at these biases today, you have to look at the context, that these are tendencies that look like errors of judgment today, but they were not like that, a few hundred million years ago. So I have this wonderful thought experiment I do in class when I talk about the idea of social proof. Let's take social proof. We talked about the practical example of social proof, what we call as herd mentality, or in Hindi, bhed chal, right? And we know that bhed chal is a common cause of destruction of wealth in the world of business and in the world of investing. Whether you're a stock market investor or whether you are a business operator, if you are blindly copying what your peers are doing, it's common cause for destroying. So if you are, you know, recklessly expanding your balance sheet because others are doing, if you're recklessly going on an acquisition spree because others are doing the same thing, and so on. And of course, there are many other tendencies that combine. You know, the envy part comes in, and you know, the loss aversion comes in. You don't want to lose market share. Everybody is growing, so I have to grow too, and all that. So there are incentives in place. There is easy money out there available from private markets and public markets. So I'm not getting to that. Let's focus on the social proof part itself. That we know that social proof is bad. You know, it's not considered good in the world of investing and in the world of running businesses. But the fact is that it is there in us for a reason, and a very, very good reason. And I like to do this thought experiment in the classroom to explain the principles of evolution and how they play out. And I think it's a good way to show them how this works. So evolution is basically three rules, right? There are only three rules here. One of them is that offsprings resemble parents, and half the genes come from mom and half the genes come from dad. That's the mathematical reality. The second rule is that the process of the transmission of genes from one generation to the next generation is not perfect. There are copying errors, and we call them mutations. And today everybody knows what mutations is. 2 years ago, a lot of students didn't know what mutations is means. So there are these copying errors, and this is the random process. You don't know which gene will, you know, not copy exactly. It will be, there will be random errors in the process. And the third rule is that in any given species, there will be some members who will die early as compared to other ones. And they will die before they can have children, either because they were unlucky and, you know, or they had a defect, or they had a bad gene. Which did not fit the environment, and therefore we learn about the idea of the survival of the fittest. So the thought experiment goes like this: that imagine that you are a bird on a beach, which doesn't have the social proof gene, so they don't fly when they see other birds fly. They only fly when they see danger themselves. They don't fly when other birds are flying, when they saw danger. And obviously, the average life expectancy of this flock of birds is going to be low compared to other flocks of birds who have the social proof gene. Now, imagine that due to a fluke in transmission of genes from one generation to another, a baby chick is born and she has the social proof gene, which is that she has now the ability or the tendency to fly away the moment she sees other birds fly away, even though she herself has not seen any predator. Now suddenly this particular bird has acquired an advantage over other birds who don't have this gene. So what will happen? What are the mathematical outcomes? This bird is likely to live longer, and because it will live longer, it will pass on its genes to the next generation, including the social proof gene, which is now in it. It will go to its kids. But the other birds will not live long enough to reproduce, so they will go out of the gene pool. Or if they live long enough to have kids, they will not pass on the gene because they never had it in the first place. So in the gene pool, the social proof gene will propagate, which means that if it is good for a species to be aware that you should run away the moment anybody in your species, in your flock of birds, senses danger, you will get that tendency. And it will take a long time for it to happen. It may take a few hundred thousand years for it to happen, but it's slow, but it is there. And these are laws of evolution that have been documented and proven over a long period of time, so we don't have to get into that. The point I'm making is that social proof makes a lot of sense in the context of evolution. It's almost always the right thing to do. But when you look at it in the modern context of the world of business or financial markets, it's almost always the wrong thing to do because the world has changed. So when you are fighting social proof, you have to first thing is recognition that I have this. It's probably a good thing to have. It's there in it for a reason. And if my ancestors didn't have it, then I wouldn't be here today. And there are so many, and by the way, this doesn't just apply to social proof, it applies to every single tendency. You can show, and there's a biological sort of linkage to every single tendency that we have, whether it is insensitivity to base rates or whether it is loss aversion. I mean, you may pick any of them. It can be shown that these tendencies are there in us for a reason. So we have to recognize that it is going to be difficult because we're really fighting billions of years of evolutionary change, and these things are there in us. Our brains are wired like that. So you're really trying to rewire your brain because you sat in a behavioral finance workshop or a course taught by a professor in 20 sessions. It's not going to be easy to do that. All the professor will be able to do is to show you that there are these tendencies, try to recognize them in yourself, and then try to rewire your brain. And there are ways to do it. They don't always work, but there are ways to do it. One way to do it is to observe how others have done it. Right? So we, in the world of business and investing, observe the survivors. Observe the people who have thrived in this particular field, in this profession. How did they think? How have they coped with different changes that have happened in the industry, for example? And you will see the pattern emerging that they have an independent mind, that they don't want to do foolish things, even though they may look foolish. The same point that I made earlier in the context of, you know, Warren Buffett. So they completely don't care about what other people think about them. And by the way, some people are wired like that. They really don't care. And I think they make great investors. At least they have the attribute of not worrying about what others think is a great attribute to have for any investor out there, especially who's a sort of a value investor. So there are ways and there are tricks that you can do to be able to deal with these issues. But you know, I can't go into it in more detail than one example that I'm giving you, because I can go on and you'll run out of time.
That's right, a lot of time here. Recklessness and social proof, two subjects, I think. And one idea which I can connect to it at this point of time is cryptocurrencies, right? Mm-hmm. Buffett has called Bitcoin as rat poison squared, and Charlie Munger has called it contrary to the interests of civilization, right? In your recent interaction with Radhika, right, at Edelweiss Connect, you said that your view on bitcoins is like grabbing a popcorn and just watching the show happen, right? Because the value lies somewhere between zero to a lot. Right, but just want to seek your specific view on cryptocurrencies as a concept, as an idea.
So, by the way, the interview happened only a few days ago, so my views really haven't changed, at all on that. But I'll elaborate a little bit. I have these role models, and Buffett and Munger, we all know, role models. They're role models for you, for me, for many of your listeners. But it's important to not given to what is called as bias from over influence of authority, a term that is coined by none other than Charlie Munger. That there are these people, they are super smart and intelligent, and you adore them and you revere them, but you can't assume that they will always be right. So that's one thought that comes to mind when I think about cryptocurrencies. And then there are these other people who I also admire, who are actually very pro cryptocurrencies, and people like Naval, for example, Ravi Kant, or Balaji Srinivasan. These are people who are very pro cryptocurrencies, the role that they will play, they will change the world and so on and so forth. And they have their view. And then there are these other people like Buffett and Munger and now lately Nassim Taleb, who also I admire greatly, who have very strong views that the value of these things is basically nothing. Sure. Now, the question that I ask myself is, do I need to have a view, by the way? Am I a fund manager in cryptocurrencies? The answer is no. Can I live my life without them? So far, the answer is yes. Do I have to make a judgment today? To me, the answer is no. So why not just, I was telling Adhika, get some popcorn and watch the fun. These guys are arguing. And why do you have to have... So the whole thing is about detachment, right? I don't need to have a view on this. Why should I have a view on this subject? It's a complex subject. I do have some views on a general level of which I want to share with you. One of the things that I want to talk about in the context of cryptocurrencies, without being any view on whether we should buy them or sell them, or I don't have any views on that. I don't own any of them, by the way. And that view is this, that I know that very, very smart people, very intelligent people, when they become old, they become unaware of the possibilities of new things and new ideas and new concepts and new theories. And Einstein was one of these guys. Einstein was one of the most admired thinkers of the world, and he denounced quantum mechanics because he was so wedded to his own theory of relativity, for which he, you know, won so much acclaim around the world. And he was the smartest, one of the smartest thinkers that we know about. And it's just that as I've observed some of the really smart people, some of my own role models, I know that, you know, they collect this baggage. You know, as I mentioned earlier, you have all this experience and it's taught you a lot of things. But it also tantamounts to baggage that you've collected. So you're automatically not open to new ideas. And things that don't make sense today will make sense tomorrow. A lot of people talk about electric vehicles, you know, they don't make economic sense. Who will buy EVs? The same thing was being said about the first automobile, you know, more than 100 years ago. The same thing was being said about telephones. So if you look at innovation, if you look at the history of innovation, you will find a lot of things appear to be useless right now, but the utility becomes apparent many, many years from now. So I know this for sure. I don't know whether this applies to cryptocurrencies or not. I would like to know, but I'm not in a rush to find out. I will have my popcorn and watch the fun.
What's a piece of commonly accepted investment wisdom that you totally disagree with?
There are actually many, not just one. I'll talk to you about maybe, you know, two or three of them. One of them is, you know, I've been always been fascinated. This is something that I picked up long back when I read Buffett's essay, 1984 essay called The Super Investors of Graham and Dodsville. And there's a section in that essay when he basically says that the whole idea of risk and return being positively correlated is nonsense. And if you're a value investor, then to earn more money, you have to take less risk. And that sort of hit me when I read it because it looks too obvious to me to be true. But since then, that was like, I discovered this in 1990s, early 1990s. And since then, you know, 25, 30 years have gone by, but I don't see that change. You know, any academic book that you pick up, anybody you talk to in financial markets, they always assume this whole thing that if you want to earn more money, you have to take more risk. Nobody does deep thinking into thinking as to what happens when you start taking risks. And if you keep taking risks, you blow up. People are not looking at what really happens in the practical world, that if you take risks, if you take extraordinary risks, you don't end up with high returns, you end up with getting killed. And I find this whole thing, this commonly accepted wisdom, that risk and return are positively correlated, and all sorts of theories and, you know, capital asset pricing model and all kinds of capital allocation models have been built on this basic assumption that to earn more return, you must take higher risk. And if you are not taking risks, you should be satisfied with a lower return. I always found this to be sort of a crazy, crazy accepted wisdom, which is not true. That's one part of it. The other thing which I'm very fascinated about is this whole thing about indexing. You know, the indexing has become very popular around the world, and the world is becoming more indexed and talking about, you know, index funds and all. But you see, we are living in a world where we've seen a long bull market for a very long period of time. And people have done well by putting their money in index funds, which don't have a view on fundamental analysis. They don't care about the business. They only care about the stock in an index. And as the world becomes more indexed, one old principle comes to mind, which is any idea which is a good idea to begin with, if it becomes very popular or too popular at some stage, there is a tipping point, it tends to become a bad idea. And I don't know where the tipping point is. But I do feel that to believe that indexing is good is actually something that I disagree with. I don't know when this will turn out to be true, but I do feel that one thing that is clearly happening is that a stock gets into the index, people have to buy it necessarily because they are running index funds and there is so much money in those funds and people are pouring money in those funds. So you're creating situations where the value of a business in the market is delinked from the underlying fundamentals. There is no change in underlying fundamentals just because this particular stock has gone into the list of an in to be included in an index will attract a lot of cash and its price will go up, and vice versa is also true. So stocks are going to be thrown out. Now obviously this increases volatility, and my view is that when will the time come when two things will happen? One, we see a severe long bear market. So what happens to people who have put money in index fund and have only seen, you know, long-term upswing, when they see a 10-year bear market, when markets are down 30, 40, 50%, what happens when your NAV sheets on the index fund is showing negative returns? What happens when index funds start seeing major redemptions? Because then what appears to be a sort of a virtuous circle will become a vicious circle, right? When on a global level, if people start withdrawing money from index funds, they will be required to sell those stocks. Who are they going to sell to? So there will be a collapse in prices. I mean, it's not difficult to visualize because we've seen something like that. We've seen flash crashes. We've seen what happens when there's sudden withdrawal of liquidity from some people who own things for reasons that have got nothing to do with fundamentals, but only to do with the fact that they happen to be in a list. So my question is that after we, and the reason why this is happening is because it's very popular and it's a good idea which has been propagated by people who believe in efficient markets. It has been endorsed by Vanguard. It's endorsed by a lot of people who I admire, including Warren Buffett, that, you know, it's better to be a passive investor than to be an active investor. Now, this is one idea that I actually, it's become sort of a conventional wisdom, and it may have been right for 25, 30 years, but whether it will always be right, I challenge that. So there's the second one. And the third one is this whole obsession about benchmarks and performance and shifting away from your own personal goals. You see, people don't look at investing as a way to meet your financial goals, whatever the goals may be. They keep thinking about, you know, how is that fund doing and how is this one doing and how is this scheme doing and how is that scheme doing and this index doing and that index doing and how am I doing? If you get into that kind of a comparison game, it's always, you know, like kids in school comparing their marks. Tero kitne aaye, mujhe kitne aaye, uspe you will always be miserable if you do that, because there will always be some kid who got better marks in some subject or even overall. You can't do great on everything all of the time. So it's a sure shot sign of creating misery, whereas it also takes away the focus from your life goals, you know, your financial goals. What are they? You know, can you meet those goals by earning a decent return through equity market? If the answer is yes, then who cares about what benchmarks and what index and what other funds and all that? It doesn't really matter. It shouldn't matter. But I completely disagree with this whole thing, this whole industry that has come up, which keeps talking about relative returns and without thinking about the objectives of the investors and what should really matter to them.
That's right. I think I agree. The comparison is, I think, one of the biggest traps that we're living in, whether we're comparing marks, as you said, or we're comparing returns. So doesn't work that way. So onto the idea of financial independence, right? In your interview with Yan a few years back, you mentioned that you became financially independent in 2001, which meant that you did not work for money anymore, and rather your work worked for you, your money worked for you. So what do you advise students on this idea of financial independence, and what are the key variables people need to work on to achieve the same?
So the role of financial independence, my thoughts on this have become more evolved over the years, including later years when I become a little more spiritual, as you mentioned earlier, because I've seen a lot of people who are non-materialistic and very happy. Right? There are a lot of people out there in the world who are very wise, who can see the world the way it really is, but they have no material attachments. So think about this for a moment. For those people, whether they are sages or prophets or rishis or munis or, you know, people who are non-material but very happy, even poor people, they are sometimes extremely happy without having a lot of assets. So that's one part I wanted to talk about. I do appreciate what Charlie Munger once said, and it influenced me a lot, that, you know, he wanted to be wise, and financial independence for him was a means to an end. So he could become, he could look at the world the way it really is and not be influenced by all sorts of mal incentives out there, including the incentive cost bias that is clearly there if you are working for a company and you're dependent on a salary. So he said, I want to have enough money that I can do whatever I like. It gives me freedom. Sure, I accept that point that you have freedom and you have happiness and you can do what you want with your time. Something that even you wrote about, I think a few days ago. So yes, if you want to be wise, you should have financial independence. That's one theory. But you, this is not the only path to wisdom. There is another path. There is a completely different spiritual path. And of course, since I'm a professor in a of finance and investing, I don't think I need to give a lot of gyan on the spiritual path. There are a lot of better teachers out there who can do that. I just wanted to highlight that to become wise, one path is to get financial independence. The other path is to, you know, be non-materialistic completely and go down that road. Now, to ask, you asked me about, you know, what do you advise students on this idea of financial independence? So of course, I'm assuming that they are not going down the spiritual path. They are going down the path of making money and becoming financially independent, which is absolutely fine. I talk about this in my class a lot, about the importance of frugality, especially in the early years of their life. So, you know, you have all these temptations. A lot of the students get jobs and they get job offers and they get credit card offers, they get home loan offers, they get car loan offers. They have all these pent up demand, you know, emotions of not spending money, not having enough money to spend on themselves, and they want to eat out. And so there are all sorts of temptations that capitalism will throw at you when you start making money, some money. Avoid those temptations. It's important. Reframe your P&L. You're entitled to enjoy what is left over after you have set aside money for a nest egg, which you will invest into, if something is left over, which means you have to massively compromise. You'll see other people spending a lot of money, having new cars and homes and clothes and whatnot, and eating out and having a lot of fun. But you won't do that. And this is what I tell my students very emphatically in the classroom and elsewhere through emails, that you have to build a nest egg and you have to compound. You have to allow the power of compound interest to play its part, because you need to have a long runway. You need to give a few years of compounding before you reach that point. And therefore, you have to treat your salary income as one source of income, and your portfolio that you're building as another source. You want to build your portfolio. So it's almost like an operating business. So you have an operating business. This is your job, and you're earning some money from that, and then you are taking money out of that and putting it in the treasury, which is your, you know, the treasury assets. So you build, and so you want the treasury assets to become large enough at some point of time, and you don't need the job. Then you can truly call yourself a financial. So that was one point of it, that the importance of frugality and building a nest egg and compounding money and not giving instant gratification and all that. That is one part of it. The other part of it is the importance of keeping your expectations low. So when you talk about financial independence, it doesn't mean you have to have 100 crores. For a lot of people, the amount of money that they need to call themselves as truly financially independent is very, very different from that of somebody who has a lot of ambition in terms of, you know, what his needs and wants are. So if you keep your needs low, but not so low that you are absolutely poor, you will be able to claim that I'm financially independent much earlier than somebody who says I need to have this and I need to have that and I need to have this other thing. So the question is, what's your number? You know, the famous movie, I think one of the Wall Street movies, has this wonderful dialogue between two guys, and one guy is asking the other guy, what's your number? Basically saying, you know, what is the net worth that you need to have before you can say that I'm calling it a day and I'm retiring? And the fellow thinks about it and he said, more. And this is actually a reflection of human nature, because if you really look at the world out there, a lot of people spend a lot of time giving the same answer, more. They just want more and more and more and more. It's never enough because the needs keep increasing. It will never be enough. And, you know, I read this many years ago, money is a drug. If you think of money as a drug, as an addictive drug, then obviously you will behave like a drug addict. You will want more of it. You want more and more of the drug because it's not doing anything for you that it was doing the previous time. So you want more and more of it. So you have to learn to acknowledge the role the money plays. It will give you financial independence. It will give you freedom. It will give you wisdom. But it can also turn you into a druggie. So you have to have that balance that you want to be a master and not a servant. And I see people chasing money and they can't spend it because, you know, I do feel Ben Franklin was right that he said money, wealth earned well, should also be spent well. It is there for enjoyment. So the whole thing that you're frugal early on is good, but you know, once you have enough, you have financial independence, you should lighten up. You should spend money on yourself. You should have indulgences. You should enjoy life because life is short. The same Seneca thing comes up. You can't take it with you and it will never be enough. So if you get onto that hedonic treadmill, you'll keep running after more and more and more, and you'll get more and more and more if you keep doing that pursuit with a passion. But then a day will come when you'll say, what have I done? I never actually enjoyed it. And I gave up so much in the whole process. So keep your expectations low. Be frugal in the early years. And build a nest egg. Treat it like an operating business, your job, and you know, use the money from that business. Take money out of that business and put it into a different business, which is your treasury. Make it large enough that you can do what you want in life and be truly independent. What else can I say?
And also, I think you've also mentioned about this idea of satisficing, which is Herb Simon's idea of satisficing, which is a difficult attribute to develop in a world where we are often seeking more than enough, right? More and more and more. So I just want to seek your perspective on this idea of satisficing. You've written about this a lot. You've talked about this a lot, right? I'm sure you must be facing like challenges even when you know that there's this idea of satisficing, right? The optimal solution that keeps you happy, right? What are the challenges that you continue to face over there? And how can someone not born with this gene develop this?
So it's important to appreciate the two models. One is optimizing, and as you mentioned, and one is satisficing. And satisficing, it basically helps Simon's idea that you know, what we call as the principle of good enough. And I absolutely love that when I first read about it. And of course, Charlie Munger introduced me to Herb Simon and his works, and I read his books many, many years ago. And I could relate to what Ben Graham wrote. And Ben Graham said, you know, if you are investing in equities, you should earn at least a premium over bond yields. And bond yields change. So if bond yields go to 6% and you want twice or AAA bond yields, then you should earn 12% in equities. If bond yields become 3%, you should be happy to earn 6% in equities. So it's an aspirational, it's an adjustable aspirational level. So it's a very philosophical point. If you sort of combine it with Herb Simon's idea of the principle of good enough, that if you want to be happy, one is to keep your expectations realistic and keep it not fixed, but adapt. The world is not going to give you what you want. You know, the famous song, you can't always have what you want. So if you still want to be happy, then the best way to do that is to lower your expectations. Then Ben Graham had this wonderful model. I love this absolutely. He said, I want to buy stocks which have certain attributes, but one of them is that the earnings yield is twice of AAA bond yield, which is a very powerful idea because it removes the need for you to calculate cost of equity capital. You're basically saying that, okay, I'm going around looking for opportunities, you know, in a world when the bond yields are 6%, if I can find things. And by the way, your aspiration level could be 50% above the bond yield. If you compound your capital at 9% a year when bond yields are 6% a year, you're going to do very well compared to bond investing, especially if the inflation is 3 or 4%. So you have to focus on real returns. You have to focus on returns relative to bonds. You don't have to focus on returns related to other people in other strategies. So it makes life much more simple and elegant if you become a satisficer than being an optimizer. So I've always been very, interested or being very impressed by this principle of good enough, that it is adjustable. If interest rates go up, you should earn more than otherwise. Why are you in stock? You should be in bonds. If interest rate go to 16% and bonds are not giving you at least 20-25%, stocks are not giving you 20-25%, then you should probably be in bonds. So it makes life so much more simple because it takes away the focus from optimization, which is impossible by the way to begin with. And secondly, it will make you aware of the need to lower expectations when you're facing disappointments and still be happy about the whole thing.
You've been a part of the formal education system by being a teacher at an MBA institute for the past 20 years, and you continue that, right, at a different institute, university. In a world where the pace of change is just multiplying, even as our formal education system seems insufficient to teach all that is required to thrive, what advice would you offer to your students and or young adults in self-educating themselves? And what are some of the key work and life skills they must learn and hone to do well over the next few decades?
So, you know, we both are very passionate about this whole thing about, you know, multidisciplinary thinking. We both learned from Charlie Munger about the importance of that. And I know you are teaching a paper on mental models in Flame. Flame is, by the way, a great place to go if you want to be a multidisciplinary thinker. And they have this amazing undergrad program, which I was told about just a few days ago, that you have, you know, the ability to create a degree where you are studying social sciences and humanities and physical and natural sciences and fine and performing arts and global studies all at the same time. And three different students will have different transcripts. They would have studied economics, they would have studied psychology, they would have studied European literature, they would have studied ecology, they would have studied calculus, they would have studied Spanish, they would have studied Urdu. So this is what a university which is broad-based, which actually promotes the idea of multidisciplinary thinking, actually brings to the table. And clearly I feel, and I know that you do too, that this is the attraction of acquiring generalized wisdom, right? This is what Munger has taught us and what we are doing by telling our students the same thing. That, yeah, you can be a specialist. You can become very good at one little, small little niche out there. But if you want to be wise, then you need to be a generalist. Then you need to be having a sense of the key ideas from multiple disciplines and how they work and how they synthesize and how they help you understand how the world really works. If that's what you want, if the job of educational institutions is to impart wisdom, then the way to do that is through multidisciplinary teaching. The way to do that is to design courses where students are learning from multiple disciplines and to have faculty who have the ability to teach those subjects. And I think Flame is one of the only places I know in the world which is doing this. So I'm very glad that I'm part of it. I'm glad that you're part of it. I think if you want to do this, the other thing here is, of course, about self-learning. It's a huge point that you raise. Not all education is taught in colleges and schools and universities. Most education happens outside. And today, for somebody who wants to learn, he has so many avenues. He or she has so many avenues of learning. All you need is dedication and a smartphone. There are all these wonderful courses that are out there. Many of them are free. And if you really want to learn something, it's available. So being on those platforms and also being in something like Flame where you have access to at least knowing how to be a multidisciplinary thinker, would I think make a great combination. So I do agree that while universities like Flame are doing a very wonderful thing by providing an opportunity for students to become multidisciplinary thinkers. It's also important to recognize that learning on your own is going to be a very key component of becoming good at what you want to become going forward. Because the world is changing very rapidly and universities can't do it for you. You have to do it on your own and you have to keep up to date with what is happening. So you need access to those platforms as well.
That's right. In the last 5 years, what new belief, behavior or habit has most improved your life? And overall, what habit would you say most positively impacts your life?
Detachment, particularly from my own conclusions, is one. You know, the whole idea of thinking like a Bayesian, that you have an initial hypothesis, a view on which you acted, but it's just a working hypothesis that you almost certainly your views will change over time. They will get either intensified or they will get diluted, and it's okay. And it doesn't matter what you have told the whole world when you have taken the decision. You have to stick to your attachment is to the process. Your detachment is from outcomes. So I think if you want to be a better thinker, it's important to really, really go deeper into this whole spiritual idea of detachment. I mentioned this earlier. I'll come back to it again. The second thing is contemplation. That you're taking an idea and looking at it from multiple perspectives. I gave a talk. One of my most popular lectures was a talk based on a movie called Vantage Point, where I picked up one company and I looked at it from 8 different points of view. But I think it's a very interesting way of thinking. And if you read literature on contemplation, that is exactly what it is. It's again a very spiritual idea. Take one idea, take one object, and look at it from multiple perspectives, multiple directions. Multiple angles. That itself, I think, is very, very helpful. So if I'm looking at a business, I will look at it from the point of view of the customer, from the point of view of the employees, from the point of view of the shareholders, from the point of view of the regulators, from the point of view of the competitors, and so many other ways of looking at it. If I'm looking at the journey, I'm thinking about what if this happens, what if that happens. It's all about contemplation. You're doing thought experiments in your head. I don't want to give examples, but there are situations available, at least to me, as I see the world out there, of areas where if things don't work out the way you want them to work out, there's no way you can lose money. But if any one of three things that happen, that should happen, all three should happen, but if any one of them could happen, you can make a ton of money. So those are obviously probabilistically very good sort of setups to have, right? That, you know, you can't lose if things don't go your way, but you do very well if even one of three things that should happen. So contemplating around those things has become a very important sort of habit for me. I'm thinking a lot about those what if scenarios. Protect the downside and think about, you know, what are the possibilities that can provide you with significant upside. The third one is the importance of becoming appreciative of the art side of our profession instead of science. I'm talking about the investing side, not the teaching side. That it is an art. It's more of an art than I think today, than I thought 5 years ago and 10 years ago. It's less of a science. It's really about appreciating beauty, and beauty really lies in the eyes of the beholder. That, and again, I come back to the point I was making earlier, that I'm very attracted to the structural beauty in a business model, which is either there or not there. And to become extremely discriminating between different qualities of businesses is something that a habit that I have been trying to inculcate, and I hope to get better at it over the next few years.
Over the years, you have recommended countless wonderful books to readers, especially on investing, decision making, business analysis. Now, even when life is the greatest teacher of all, right? suggest one of your favorite books on living a good life and your biggest lessons from that book.
So I came across this book written by an amateur. You know, she's not a philosopher. I mean, I do consider her as a philosopher, but not a sort of a PhD in philosophy or anything like that. And her name is Sharon Libel, and she wrote a book on Epictetus called The Art of Living. And I recommend that book to everyone. I've actually gifted more than 200 copies of that book. to students and friends and children of my friends and so on. I do think that this is one of the best books out there on how to live a good life, because it tells you in very simple language as to what are the things that you need to do and what are the things you need to avoid. And one of the big lessons for me have been, which I've actually incorporated not just in the way I live, but also in the way I think about investing, and I mentioned that a while back, is to only worry about things that are in your control and not give too much importance to things that are out of your control. They're not in your control, so why are you fretting over it? It's actually there, and there are many other lessons. I don't want to elaborate more on this apart from saying that buy this book, read this book. It's an amazing, amazingly well written and a book, and has influenced me a lot. The Art of Living by Sharon Lewis on Epictetus. The other one I mentioned was The Ancient Sage. You know, follow him on Twitter. All the wisdom is not going to be found in books. You know, that Twitter is a great place. It's a great place to watch people battle each other on Bitcoin while having popcorn and while having no view on whether Bitcoin is or cryptocurrencies are valuable or not, but also a good place for you to contemplate on some of the most spiritual ideas you find out there. And the Ancient Sage Twitter handle is one of them that I absolutely love.
So we're coming to the end of this conversation, Professor Bakshi, and it's been wonderful. So I have this one last question, right? So given the requirements and indulgence of lifelong learning, right, which involves sitting for long hours and reading or writing, right, I find a lot of people who end up on the wrong side of good health. And I think you also found yourself there a few years back, but have turned around your health very well. Take us through that journey of your evolution on the health front and things you have done to take better control of your health over the years.
Well, again, we come back to the Lindy effect. You know, Lindy's effect has been very influential for me. You know, the idea that, again, this I should give credit to Nassim Taleb for it. He wrote about it in more than one book of his. And he says that the older the idea, the more its durability. And when it comes to my own development, the older the ideas, the more the durability I've seen. You know, things like the importance of walking. And I know that you transformed your body through certain practices that you did, including walking. I remember many years ago you told me about that. The importance of exercising and walking, the importance of fasting. Fasting has been a game changer. Actually, I don't eat anymore. The whole thing about detachment, if you could detach yourself from the need to eat every few hours, then you can do a lot of things. Actually, fasting is a great way to practice detachment. It is obviously great for health, and there are a lot of books on the subject. Fasting has been a wonderful subject for me to learn about in the last 2 years. I now 5 days a week eat one meal a day. I fast 5 days a week, and it's great, and I feel no hunger, and people, all my friends, wonder what has happened to this guy. But and I also wonder when I look at myself. But I really don't. People have to try to see. Most people think that they can't fast. How will they do it for 24 hours, for 16 hours, 20 hours? But once you do it, your body adapts, and the hunger and the time and the energy that is required in digesting food is now directed towards other things like focus and attention. So I'm extremely focused. I don't have to think about, oh, my lunchtime is coming, what do I have to eat, you know, I have to do this and that and plan for my meal and all that. So fasting has been, and again, it's a very old practice. It's been there in all cultures. Any religion you take, you find fasting is an ingredient. It's one of the essential ingredients of all religions out there. So I've read up a lot on the concept of fasting, the spiritual side of it, the health benefits of it, all of that. Then, of course, the idea of being quiet. You know, meditation is something that is being talked about a lot, and there are meditation courses, but you don't need all that. Just being with yourself in a room which is quiet and contemplating on just one idea, or one thought, or nothing for that matter, is meditation in my view. So, and it clears up your mind. A lot of the, when we used to have hard drive, we used to call a function called defrag. Used to run a function called defrag. This is what it is. You know, when you meditate, you are emptying your mind. You're removing all sorts of influences that you have accumulated over the last few hours and defragging your mind. It really, really calms you down. And you can measure it. You can measure it through blood pressure. You can measure it through heart rate. You can measure it through so many other ways. Then the idea of breathing. One, I came across a few books on the importance of breathing correctly. And most people don't actually. And the people who breathe most incorrectly are the ones who are actually spending most of the time on the screen, like you and I are doing right now. Because they're breathing from the chest. They're not breathing from the stomach. So there are enormous advantages of breathing well. And it's an idea which has been around for thousands of years. Again, Lindy applies here. So whether it is breathing or meditation or fasting or walking, and all of them have health benefits, clearly. But I again go back to the same point. The older the idea, the more value that is likely to be there in it. So I've been, you know, learning more about these things and try to practice them and incorporate them in my life.
Great. So that's all from my side, Professor Bakshi. Thank you so much for all your insights. It's been wonderful. And thank you for having me on your list of one or two items that you had to do today. Right, and spending almost two hours of your time today, precious time with me, sharing all the insights that you had.
It's worth it because I know that whatever you do, you're doing it for the world, and you're a very wonderful human being. And I'm happy that I'm your teacher and your friend, and now your colleague. So thank you for calling me, Vishal. Look forward
thank
to
you so much, and meeting you soon. And I look forward to meet your claim very soon. Thank
Absolutely.
You so much.
Thank you.
Take care.